it's important if you're doing kind of like sound design, especially for kind of films, games in particular, to really think about what it is that you're making a sound for and what time it exists in, what space it exists in, what's it made of. Things like weapons, it's a, you know, a pretty typical one to go for, but like weapons in games are really like a good example. So, all right, yeah, there's gun sounds and whatever, but like, you know, jump forward to like, all right, someone's asked you to do a bunch of hits for a tank in a new Halo game or something, or some sort of like sci-fi gun thing that's made out of alien body parts. What does that sound like? It's not going to go bang. It's not going to sound metallic because it's not made of that. So you have to kind of change your approach based on that. You know, if you want something kind of squelchy, something weird, things like filters are a great way of kind of creating that. Let's do a little bit of that. So a lot of it is, yeah, the approach to kind of what is this thing. Also for, again, kind of anything, I guess, kind of especially longer stuff, and think things in kind of film and that. If you're designing, say, sounds for anything that is more than a one shot, if it's something that appears a bunch of times, or you're writing kind of to a moving image, what space is it in? You know, if you've got, I know, a helicopter landing outside, you probably don't want a really tight slapback studio reverb, or it's going to sound really weird. In the same sense, if you've got, you know, say a really kind of like enclosed space, you probably don't want this massive kind of like sweeping the hills are alive with the Sound of Music kind of reverb on it. So that's it. That's an important thing to think about, and I think it really informs the way that you shape sound. So if we do a bit of this, where did that go? These guys, and there we go. So with the kind of squelchy idea in mind, let's see what we can get out of this. Maybe a bit lower. Bit kind of wobbly. We can get it to sound a bit more bubbly, maybe kind of changing the waveform that's running into it. A good way to do that. Let's try, where's the ring one? There we go. So again, it's a little bit more kind of bubbly. Where's that? That's why I'm using the wrong one. That's why. Wrong bloody oscillator. Ooh, actually, no oscillator works quite well for this. So with pretty much all filters, you can feed them back. They do this nice self-resonating thing. Some filters don't do it, and they're rubbish because it's the coolest thing in the world. And just with, say, doing that with two different oscillators, and mixing them, there we go. So, another kind of like quick patch. we have three low frequency oscillators, or LFOs, which are exactly the same as this, but just they're designed to go slow. There's actually nothing going into the filter. Both sides of the filter are self-oscillating, which is a kind of handy thing that filters do. We've taken the mix output straight out into the desk, and then we've got three lines running from the three different LFOs in. These two are sine waves, so nice and, let's swap those over. It's a bit easier to follow. There we go. So these ones are all sine waves, so, you know, nice and kind of smooth sounding. Even when they go really fast, you get this kind of like sound rather than anything kind of too harsh. So you can get all these kind of like nice bubbling sounds. Let's take a bit of a... bit of spring reverb on it. These LFOs are all being modulated by this tiny little thing over here, which is a random voltage generator. You feed it a trigger signal, and you can kind of see down there, but the lights change color. This little guy. Yeah, you can see him changing color. Red is negative, green is positive voltages, and these are speeding up and slowing down these three LFOs altogether, but completely randomly. So what you end up with is... kind of weird R2-D2 noises. But, record... record a bunch of that, and because it's random, it's never going to repeat. So you could go and get a coffee, whatever, come back, and you'll have 20 minutes of really random, weird bleeps. There's still another output from this that we can use. And in fact, we can split that again and start just kind of experimenting with it and sending it to different places. So we've got... let's try feeding it into this side of the filter. So rather than... so I've just brought all the attenuators down. So rather than controlling an LFO and speeding and slowing that up, it's just controlling the cutoff of the filter. So you get almost a kind of... the BBC radiophonic sound. What else have we got that we can put in here? Maybe some crossfader. So there's a crossfader between the two filters. You can see that kind of light going a bit mad at the top. It's now going to kind of ping between two sides. If we wanted, we can get that in stereo, I think. Yeah, let's try that. Everyone likes a bit of stereo. Left. Right. Sounds kind of stereo-esque. There we go. Cool. So we've got that. And then we've still got one more. That is quite grating after a while. You can send it to, say, a pitch input on the other side. So we've now got some kind of patterns. You know, someone's going, all right, yeah, we really want just like a classic like bleeping computer system for, we're gonna remake Tron for like a third time. So you've got that, but we've now also got all of our LFOs here, but just all shrunk to zero. And we can start to blend those back in and get some kind of gliding sounds. These are all still running at a pretty kind of low rate as well. So they're going to give us all these kind of weird glides. Between things, but we can speed them up and run them kind of closer to audio rate. And you know, you have the modem dial up. Sound. All the way into weird, super high frequency noise. So yeah, nice bit of, for anyone who remembers dial-up. I've been trying to forget about it for like 10 years, but it will never go away. So again, being able to take something pretty standard, like a filter, and then modulate the crap out of it in loads of different ways, using things like kind of random voltages, which is more traditionally known as sample and hold. Here it does literally sample like a noise chip and then just holds the frequency or the voltage that's coming out of that at that exact sample moment. It's slightly different in digital systems. I think there are things that are really, really good at it. I think the Ableton sample and hold's awesome. Not sponsored by Ableton, but it is really good. And that, again, because you're not limited by things like cables, you can route that to everything if you wanted to. That's where stuff like Max MSP comes in really handy. Being able to design, you know, like a small little thing and just route it to absolutely everything. And with things like kind of the multiple and being able to split signals, means you can time everything to change, say, like, you know, at the start of a bar. If we wanted at the start of every bar loads of things to kind of randomize, then we can set that up kind of really easily, which also kind of plays into the whole, you know, being able to just let it run and just, you know, it's going to run in time, you know, it's just going to keep giving you new things on, you know, the first beat of every bar, and you can just go in and kind of like play with the knobs. I don't know if there's any features for it in Ableton yet, but there's a really good one in Logic which allows you to strip silence for things, which means you can just record like a hit at the start of every bar, mess around with the knobs, get as many weird sounds as you want, and then you just go in, strip silence, and you're just left with 200, 300 completely unique samples that you can layer with, you know, either kind of pre-existing sounds, or you can then use those as jumping off points, either for, you know, sound design for your own productions or for kind of commissioned work, which is handy.